Hello friends, I am Satyendra and today in this video lecture I will explain you the Brownian motion or the Brownian movement with its full mathematical derivation. This video on Brownian motion is extremely important for the candidates of MSc, BSc honors as well as for the students appearing for CSER, NET, GATE, JEST, TFER, etc. exams. Okay, so let's learn it. So what is Brownian motion? So a very small particle immersed in a liquid exhibits random type of motion known as Brownian motion. Okay, so what is Brownian motion? So if you immerse a very small particle, okay, in a liquid, then the particle inside the liquid will move in the random directions. It will exhibit the random motion. Okay, that type of motion is called the Brownian motion. Okay, let's see the diagram. So if you look at this diagram, assume that this was that particle here, okay, and this particle is in the system. Okay, this is the liquid. Okay, within the red box there is a liquid. Now this particle A will move in the random, will move randomly. So it will first go from here to here, and then from here to here, then here, 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 here. In this way, this particle will move in the random way. Okay, so finally, let's assume that it came to the point B. Okay, so this was B. Okay, so it has exhibited the random motion. Okay, so why it exhibits the random motion? Okay, that we will also learn. So this type of movement, this type of random movement that is exhibited by the particle A is called the Brownian motion. Okay, so the motion is produced by the thermal fluctuation of the pressure on the particle. Okay, due to fluctuation, the forces do not always cancel each other, and the particle is knocked out in a random way. Okay, so let me explain you this part. Okay, so if you at this point, if you look closely at this point A, which I have drawn it here, okay, here I have drawn that system. Okay, so this particle was in the liquid, and actually what happened, this particle experienced the collision from here. Here is also some particle. Okay, okay, so here is also some particle. Okay, so here is also some particle, here was also some particle, and here was also some particle. So these blue lines, blue particles indicate the particles of the liquid or the molecules of the liquid. These molecules collide with this particle A. Okay, so you can see that when this molecule and this molecule collided with this suspended particle, then in this way these both the forces will cancel each other. But when the particle experience the collision from this direction, the forces will not cancel each other, but it will move in this direction. Okay, so this is the reason why the particle has moved from here to here. Okay, so that was the reason why the particle moved. So this actually happens with the Brownian particle all the time in the liquid, and the motion is always random, the collisions are random, and that's why the particle moves randomly. Okay, we cannot predict, no one can predict in which direction this will move, but that always the direction of motion always depends on the type of collisions which the particle is experiencing. Okay, so this is how the Brownian motion actually come into action. Okay, so right now you have understood what is Brownian motion. Okay, now let's read further. The Brownian motion in one dimension, say x, okay, It's like a random walk along a line. In Brownian motion, we are concerned with small macroscopic particles, but the application to single atoms or molecules also have been studied. Okay, so what they are telling in this paragraph is that the Brownian motion, we always take into consideration the small macroscopic particles, okay, but today, okay, the applications to atoms and molecules have also been made with the that means the motion of atoms and molecules can also be studied with the help of Brownian motion. Okay, so this is all about the Brownian motion. Okay, so friends, you can see here I have brought one animation for you. So here you can see that this blue particle is the Brownian particle, and due to the collision it is moving randomly. Okay, so the type of motion which this blue particle is exhibiting is called the Brownian motion. Okay friends, now let's come to the mathematical treatment of the Brownian motion. Okay, so in the mathematical treatment, let's let the particle be suspended in a liquid. Okay, so we assume that the particle is suspended in the liquid. Okay, it is acted upon by a fluctuating force kt, okay, caused by the bombardment of the molecules of the liquid. Okay, so see what happened. So at this time in the scene 1, you can see that the particle was alone. Okay, there was no other particle. But in the scene 2, we have placed this molecule. This molecule is placed in the liquid. So there are the now the particle experiences the collision from the liquid particles. So you can see that here, this is the Brownian particle, and these are the particles of liquid, and these particles collide with this Brownian particle like this, okay, and like this. So in finally in the motion of this Brownian particle will be the resultant of all these vector collisions. Okay, it might go along this direction, okay, in which the force in the direction of the net force. Okay, so this is how the particle will move. So in the liquid the Brownian motion, the Brownian particle, okay, experienced a fluctuating forces. Okay, so that fluctuating force kt, okay, so that fluctuating force kt is made up of two parts. Okay, that the fluctuating force kt consists of the two parts. Okay, so the first part is the viscous drag, okay, or the frictional force. So whenever the Brownian particle move inside the liquid, it experiences the frictional force due to the liquid. Okay, and that viscous drag is equals to 6 pi eta rv. So here pi is the pi, that is 3.141. eta is the coefficient of viscosity, r is the radius of the particle or the radius of the Brownian particle, v is the velocity of the Brownian particle in the liquid. Okay, so the Brownian particle in the liquid will experience the viscous drag. Okay, and then the stochastic force. Okay, the particle also experiences another force called stochastic force. Okay, the average value of the average value of the stochastic force is zero. Okay, of average value zero, and this stochastic force represents the effect of molecular collision on the particle at rest. Okay, so this stochastic force is due to the molecular impact of liquid particles. Okay, so this force is completely a random force. Okay, and it has the average value equals to zero. Okay, so Finally, your fluctuating force KT is made up of two types of forces. So it is, the first part is the viscous drag and the other part is the stochastic force. Okay. Here, now let's go to the equation of motion of the particle. So now we will formulate the equation of motion of the Brownian particle, okay, inside the liquid. So if I have to write the equation of motion, since this is the force, this must be equals to mass into acceleration, okay. So this will form the equation of motion, okay. So now we all know that the acceleration is equals to second derivative of displacement with respect to time. So this part, mass into acceleration, can be written in this way, okay. And as I already told you that this fluctuating force is made up of the two forces, that is the viscous drag and the stochastic force. So it is the sum of these two forces, okay. So this is here we have the equation of motion here, okay. So now we also know that this second derivative of x with respect to time can be represented by 2 dot dot over x. So this is just the symbol of this differentiation, okay. So finally, just 1 minute, okay. So this term can be written like this, okay. And this velocity is the actually the first derivative of distance displacement with respect to time, okay. So dx upon dt equals to v, and that's why x dot equals to v. So that's why we have replaced the v with the x dot, okay. Okay, so this is how we got this equation, okay. Okay, now let's divide this whole equation, throughout by m. So if we divide this equation throughout by m, we will arrive at this equation, okay. Okay, now what we will do, we will now multiply this whole equation with x, okay. Okay, so we will get, so on multiplication we will get this equation, okay. You can see this equation, okay. Okay, now we are going to modify this equation in a suitable form, okay. Now you can see that the first derivative of x square is given by this chain rule, and that will come out to be this, okay. And where we have represented this first derivative of x by x dot, okay. So finally, I am going to do is that I'm equating this and this term, and then on equating I can easily find the value of this x into x dot, and this is equals to this much, okay. So I have found the value of, you can see that I have found the value of this, okay. And what I am going to do in the next part is that I will now try to find out what is the value of this quantity, okay. So let's do it. For this we have to solve the second derivative of x square with respect to dt, and that this part can be written like this, okay. And we have already calculated this part, and this is, that was equals to this, as we have already solved here. You can see that here we have solved that thing. So I have plugged the value, okay. Now what I have to do now in the second part, I have to further solve this part, okay. So I have solved this part here, you can see that, okay. I have solved it, and I have used some rules of differentiation while solving it, okay. If you have any doubt, let me know in the comment section, okay. Now this part here, you can see that there are two x dots, so that can be written like x dot square, okay. So this is how we can, I can write that equation, okay. Now what I am going to do, I am now equating this part and rearranging in this form, in this way, okay. So you can rearrange that in this way, and then I can solve it for this much quantity, okay. So this is how I have got this value, okay. So you can also you can see that how I brought this value, okay. So what I am going to now is that I am going to plug the value of, okay, let me rub little bit, okay. So what I will do now, I will plug this value from here in this part, okay, and this value in this part. Okay, so on plugging the value, I will get this, I will get this equation. Okay, if I will plug these values, okay, in this equation, then I will get this equation, which is very clear. Okay, now we have to further do some more modifications in this equation. Okay, now by the law of equipartition of energy, okay, we know the law of equipartition of energy, which is stated here. Okay, so you can read it. The average kinetic energy of a molecule per degree of freedom equals to half kBT. Okay, so average kinetic energy is written here, where V square is the mean of V square. Okay, so this represents the average or the mean kinetic energy, okay, of a molecule, and according to the law of equipartition of energy, that must be equals to half kBT. Since we are dealing only with the x direction, we will have only 1 degree of freedom. Okay, for the 1 degree of freedom, that will be half kBT, and the average kinetic energy is here. So we also know that, as I have already explained to you, that v is equals to x dot, because v is equals to dx over dt. Okay, so that is represented with the x dot. So that is why I have written here v equals to x dot. Okay, so this is how we got this equation, and then with this equation can further be we can further find out the value of x dot square and the mean of that. Okay, so that is here. Okay, so what I will do now. Okay, so this is I have got this value, and I will later I will use this value. Okay, so before that we have to do one thing. Okay, what we have to do is that by equation 2, that means by in this equation, okay, so in this equation what I have to do is that we have taking the mean of each term. So what we are doing now is that in this equation, that means in this equation, I am taking the mean of each term. Okay, so on taking the term, taking mean means that I will represent the mean by this symbol. Okay, so if I take the mean of any term, I will place the term inside this. Okay, so in this equation, I have taken the mean of each term, so that becomes like this. Okay, you can see that in this equation, I have taken mean on both the sides. Okay, and that approximately becomes equal to this. Okay, so now as I have already found the value of this quantity here. Okay, so now I will plug the value of this quantity from here. Okay, in this equation. Okay, so in this equation I will plug the value. So where I can plug the value is that here. Okay, so let's go to next part. Okay, so friends, as I have told you that I will plug the value of this from this equation into here. Okay, at this point. Okay, and then the value of this quantity, okay, the value of this quantity will also be substituted in equation number 4. Okay, and the value of this quantity is equals to 0. The reason is that as you can read here, because x and a of t are uncorrelated and a t varies completely randomly, that is why the mean of this quantity, okay, x, the product of x and a of t is equals to 0. Okay, we will also use this. Okay, and then let us put since this whole quantity is a constant, let's put it equals to beta, and let's put the value of this mean is equals to alpha. So putting all these values, okay, these values and this value, okay, in this equation, so this equation will become a small and simplified equation on putting all those values. Okay, so let's put it. So on putting the values, equation number 4, that means our just seen equation, that's the previous equation, that will become in this form. Okay, that will come in this form. Okay, now what I can do, I can further simplify this equation in this way, okay, by multiplying this whole equation by 2, okay, and then I can rearrange this equation further, okay, and let's name it equation number 5, okay. So this is the equation number 5, and now what we have to do, now we have to solve this equation, okay. Okay, so how to solve this equation? As you can see that this is a linear differential equation, okay. So this is the linear differential equation, and it is of the following form, okay. So it is of the this form, okay, where this P and Q are constant or the function of X, okay. So we can also see that here, according to this equation, okay, here you can see that. So first let me discuss with you about this linear differential equation, okay. So in this linear differential equation, the integrating factor is given by this term, okay, and the solution of this linear differential equation is given by this equation, okay, where, okay. So what we will do, we will compare this this whole thing with this equation, and then we will try to write the solution of this equation with the help of this already well known equation, okay. So we will do that, okay. Now in this, if you look closely at in this equation, okay, if you look closely at this equation, then you will find that you are in this case, if you compare with this equation, okay, let me rub it little bit. So if you will compare this equation with this equation, then you will find that your x equals to t, then alpha equals to y, your p is equals to alpha, okay, sorry, p is not equals to alpha, p is equals to, your p is equals to beta, and your y is equals to alpha, because here also y is equals to alpha, okay, and then this quantity is equals to q, okay. This is how you have to compare these two equations, and then you have to find the integrating factor, and then we will write the solution with the help of this already well known solution, okay. So how to solve, so let's solve this equation number 5, okay. Let's see how to solve this equation number 5. So on comparing, we easily find that p equals to beta, y equals to alpha, q equals to this term, okay. So integrating factor is found out in this way, okay. Okay, now this is the solution written with the help of this standard solution. We have written the solution, okay. So what I am going to do now is that I am going to plug the value of this integrating factor at this point. So I have written the value of integrating factor, I also have also written the value of q at this point, okay. From here you can see that the value of q was substituted, the value of integrating factor is again substituted, okay, and this is the constant of integration, okay. So further what we have to do is that we have to solve solve this equation, and you can easily find that this is the constant, so it came outside the integration, and we are only left with this much equation, okay. So we are left with this much equation. So on further solving that integration, okay, you can see that, okay, so we will further solve this integration inside it, okay, and let me tell you what formula we will use to solve it, okay. So we can solve it by using this formula, because the integration of e a t equals to e a t upon a, okay. So this is the formula that we will use to solve this equation, okay. So this is how in the next step we have solved that equation. So we have solved that integration part in this way, okay. You can see that, okay, it is very clear, okay, how we solve this, okay. Now we will divide this whole equation, dividing the whole equation by this factor, okay. So we will reach at this equation on division. You can see that on division we will reach at this equation, okay. Now let's think about this term in more detail, okay. So this term becomes negligible after some time, because, okay, because you can see that this term can be written in this form, because here what I have done, I have substituted the value of this beta from my previous assumed term, okay. So previously I have assumed it beta to be something, so I have substituted the value of beta at this point. You can see that, okay. And now, since m is the mass of the particle, and the mass of the particle, Brownian particle, is really very small, really very small, okay. So what actually happens, these terms become a very large term, okay. So finally what will happen, okay, so this this term becomes very large term, and this factor, okay, that means this term can be written like this, and that can be sent to the denominator because there was negative sign in the power, okay. So that can be written like this, and since this term is very large, this term is very large, so this term is very very large, will become very very large with the time, and so this this will also become a very large term in the denominator, and that will give you almost a negligible term, okay. So this whole term will become a very negligible term. So this is the reason why we will now neglect this term in our further equations, okay. Okay, so finally we will neglect this term, and our this equation will become like this equation, okay. Okay, now what I am going to do, I am putting back the value of alpha. So the value of alpha was assumed to be this, okay. So I have put back the value of alpha, so the equation becomes like this, okay. Now this whole equation, this part can be written like this. Of course this is inappropriate to write, but approximately this term can be written like this, but in reality, talking about the reality, it is now not, it should not be equal, okay. But approximately we are dealing with Brownian motion, so we can write it like this, okay. Okay, so this term is written like this, so we have taken out the operator d over dt, okay. Okay, so now what I am going to, I am further sending this dt at this point, okay, and then integrating this whole equation under the proper limits. So here the x will go from 0 to x, and in the the time will go from 0 to t. So when the time will go from 0 to t, the particle will move from 0 to x, okay. So this is the how I have put the limits of the integration, okay. Okay, now on integration I arrive at this point, okay. So how I got this, you might be wondering, okay. So the reason is that integration of dx is equals to x, okay. So I have used this formula, okay, and I have put the limits, I have properly put all the limits. So here also, okay, the limits have been put properly, okay. So this is that equation. Now on putting the values of limit, I arrive at this equation, okay. So now let's try to understand that what is the meaning of this this term of mean of x square, okay. So what is the meaning of this, so what is this, okay. So let's see. So during the interval t equals to 0 to t equals to t, so I have taken the limits t equals to 0 to t equals to t in the integration, okay. So let s be the displacement, okay, and x be the x component of s, okay. So let the same particle be observed at different be observed at same regular interval t. So we observe the same particle at different intervals of t. So first we observe at t, then 2t, then 3t, then 4t, okay, etc. And for each x, okay, and for each x, so we get for this interval, okay, we get some x, then for this we get some x, then for this we get some x, okay. So in this way we get different x's. So for each x, then for each x is calculated, okay. So what we do then, we then with the help of the lots of x that we have calculated, okay, we calculate this this mean, okay, this mean of x square, okay. So so this mean is the mean of squared displacement along x in the interval t, okay. So this is what is the meaning of this mean, okay. Okay, this mean of x square does not give the actual path. So this is an important thing, that this does not give the actual path, but the motion is so complicated that that this quantity, okay, this mean of x square is only the quantity that can be determined. Okay, since the Brownian motion is so complicated that we cannot calculate the actual path, the true path in which the particle has moved, but this is the only quantity, that is the mean of x square. Okay, so the mean of square displacement can only be determined experimentally. Okay, now this mean of x square has some loose relation with the actual path. Okay, so now let's put back the value of beta. Okay, now we are putting back the value of beta. We have supposed the value of beta to be this, and now we will put back the value of beta in our above equation, in this equation. Okay, let's put the value. So on putting the value of beta, this equation becomes like this. Okay, and then it further becomes like this. Okay, and then what we will do at this point, we have further put the value of k. So k was the Boltzmann constant, and the relation between k are the gas constant, and n is the Avogadro number. So the relation between gas constant and Avogadro number and Boltzmann constant is given by this equation. Okay, so I have used this equation. So this equation can also be written like this. Okay, so this is the final relation, very important relation for the Brownian motion, and this equation is called the Einstein equation. Okay, so here I have written the meaning of each term. So R is the gas constant, N is the Avogadro number, N is the coefficient of viscosity, R is the radius of the particle which executes Brownian motion. So R is the radius of Brownian particle, T is the absolute temperature in Kelvin, T is the time. Okay, so the above relation, that is equation number 5, equation number 7. Okay, so you have this equation. Okay, so this equation in which I have put in the box. So this equation is called the Einstein equation. Okay, so the above equation, so the above relation, equation 7, is called the Einstein equation. It says that the mean value of the square of the displacement of Brownian particle during the time interval t along x is proportional to this time. Okay, so the equation number 7 says that, let's go to equation number 7. Okay, so this is the equation number 7. So this equation number 7 says that the mean of the squared displacement, so this is the mean of the squared displacement, is proportional to the time t. Okay, along the, so this shows that as the time t as the time passes, this squared displacement also increases. Okay, so it reveals that the particle is moving. Okay, it says that the particle is not stationary, in fact it is moving, its squared displacement is increasing. So it reveals the Brownian motion, it reveals the random motion. Okay, so this is what it was written. It says that the mean value of the square of the displacement of the Brownian particle during the time interval t along x is proportional to this time. Okay, so there is an experimental proof. So that equation number 7 is experimentally verified, is an experimentally verified equation. Okay, so experimental proof was, so Perrin verified the Einstein's equation, that is the equation number 7. In particular, the dependence of mean of squared displacement, okay, in particular the dependence of this on the time interval t, temperature t, the viscosity eta, and the radius r. So the Perry verified the Einstein equation. Okay, and it verified that this mean of squared displacement depends on the time interval t, temperature t, viscosity eta, and radius r. So Perrin has verified this fact, this equation number 7. Okay, so now further, thus we have a convincing proof of the molecular collision. Okay, so we have the convincing proof of the molecular collision and hence the existence of molecules. Since there are molecular collisions, so there should be molecules. Okay, and the verification of molecular kinetic theory, and so this Brownian motion also proves the existence of molecular kinetic theory, or it verifies the molecular kinetic theory. Okay friends, thanks for watching this video. Okay, thank you very much. If you really like to support our this channel, okay, so share with your friends, like this video and subscribe this channel. Okay friends, thank you very much.